وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. Today is going to be our second day on the explanation of كتاب بلوغ المرام من أدلة الأحكام written by حافظ بن حجر العسقلاني رحمه الله. The book that we're doing is كتاب الحج. نعم. This hadith, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, أَيُّمَا صَبِيٍّ, any child who performs hajj, ثُمَّ بَلَغَ الْحِنْثَ, and then he reaches the age, meaning he reaches puberty, فَعَلَيْهِ أَن يَحُجَّ حَجَّةً أُخْرَى, this person has to do a what? Another hajj. وَأَيُّمَا عَبْدٍ, any slave. حَجَّ, who does hajj. ثُمَّ أُعْتِقَى, and then he's freed after he done hajj. So he already did hajj as a slave, but now he is freed and he's no longer a slave. فَعَلَيْهِ أَن يَحُجَّ, he has to do hajj, حَجَّةً أُخْرَى, another hajj again. The previous hajj, he gets rewarded for it, but he is not, but it's not Hajjatul Islam. That one he has to do again. Rawahu ibn Abi Shayba. Ibn Abi Shayba narrated. Al-Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated it. وَرِجَالُهُ ثِقَاتِ, and the men in this train are authentic, Ibn Hajar says. إِلَّا أَنَّهُ, but the only issue is اِخْتُلِفَ فِي رَفْعِهِ, there is a dispute whether this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam statement, وَالْمَحْفُوظُ أَنَّهُ مَوْقُوفٌ, and there is another opinion that says, no, that this is the statement of who? That this is the statement of Abdullah ibn Abbas. And it's not the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who said this. But the chain is what? But the chain is authentic. That which is authentic and it's sahih is that the hadith is marfu', that it's the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Ibn Hajar in great detail, marfu', when I say marfu' means it's the statement of the Messenger. Again, I mentioned there was two opinions. There is one group of scholars who are saying that this is the statement of Abdullah ibn Abbas, that it's mawquf, وَلَا يَصِحُ مَرْفُوعًا. Another group of scholars are saying, no, this is Abdullah ibn Abbas attributing it to the Prophet. So it's the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that which seems apparent is that it's marfu'. Hafidh ibn Hajar, in his kitab Talkhis al-Habir, he went in great details to discuss this issue. If you go to the second volume, page 220, he discusses it more. This hadith, also Ibn Khuzaymah narrated it. And Al-Imam al-Tabarani in his Awsat, Al-Hakim in his Mustadrak, and Bayhaqi in his Sunan. All of them narrated from the chain of Muhammad ibn Milhan, who said, حدثنا يزيد ibn زريع, who then said, I heard it from Shu'bat ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki, who heard it from Al-A'mash, Sulaiman ibn Mihran, who heard it from Abi Dhabyan, who heard it from Abdullah ibn Abbas. The only person in this chain who narrated from Shu'bah marfu'an is Yazid ibn Zari'in. Every other person who narrated from Shu'bah, none of them narrated it marfu'an. They all narrated it mawkufa. That's where the discussion came from. That's where the discussion came from. Lakin, as I said to you, inshallah ta'ala, it's sahih and there's no need to go into that discussion in more details now. This hadith also points out the acceptance of the hajj of the child. The child does hajj, that his hajj is accepted, even if he doesn't reach age of puberty. His hajj is accepted. But it doesn't suffice him, it doesn't remove the obligation of hajjatul Islam. The hajj of Islam is still upon this child when he reaches age of puberty. And that's the time when we know that the child is actually at what? He's at that age of mu'akhadha, he's punished if he doesn't do something. So that is the age where he needs to come with hajj, puberty. A question and a discussion here is, what about if he reaches age of puberty in hajj? He's doing hajj. He's in the middle of hajj. And he reaches age of puberty whilst in the state of hajj. If it is before he does the ihram, before he actually puts on his ihram, then there is no dispute amongst the scholars that this is now considered hajjatul Islam. So if he came from his country and before he wore his ihram, he reached age of puberty, there is no dispute amongst the scholars, and that's not a discussion at hand, that that child has reached age of puberty before the ihram, before he can come with the intention. Well, what about after ihram? It's the biggest discussion. He is in a state of ihram. If this is before Arafah, so he's in ihram, he's landed, he passed miqat, Arafah hasn't come. Arafah has not happened yet. Ajza'at, it will suffice him from hajjatul Islam. It will suffice him from hajjatul Islam. Ala al-rajih min aqwali ahli al-ilmi, from the strongest of the opinions of the scholars. Because the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, which we're going to see, al-hajju arafah. Hajj is arafah. That is what hajj is. ولذلك, anyone who doesn't go to Arafah, there's no hajj for him. Hajj is Arafah. That is what hajj is. It's Arafah. Without it, there's no hajj for you at all. So if he reaches age of puberty before Arafah, no problem. What about the night? What about the night of Muzdalifah? At night in Muzdalifah, he reaches age of puberty, and he still has a chance to go to Arafah. The time of Arafah in which he could stand is still remaining. Walau lahza, even if it's a split second, he catches Arafah, that's also what? The hajj that he doesn't have to ever come with. It suffices him, inshallah ta'ala. Another point that we need to point out from the hadith is, The hadith shows that the slave, his hajj is also what? Accepted before he's freed. He can do hajj, but that it doesn't suffice him from what? Hajjatul Islam. It doesn't. He has to do it again. Naam. So this hadith restricts the other hadith, right? Where the woman lifted her child, and what did she say? Alihada hajj, there's hajj on this one? That hadith, some of the scholars, what do they understand from that? They understood from that it suffices him for hajjatul Islam. Like in this hadith that we took, hadith from Abbas here, It restricts it and shows that the Hajj is accepted that he did, but it doesn't uplift the obligation of Hajj from him when he reaches age of puberty. So this hadith is a muqayyad. It's restricting the other general hadith of the woman who asked about her child. Naam. This hadith, Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated it. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give a khutbah. And the Messenger said, لا يخلوان رجل, a man should not be alone, بمرأة, a woman, إلا ومعها ذو محرم. A man should not be alone with a woman, by herself, him and her in a room. No one else is in that room. That should not happen. لا يخلوان رجل, a man should not be alone, بمرأة, a woman, إلا ومعها ذو محرم, unless there is a mahram with them. There has to be a what? There has to be a mahram. A mahram is three things. Anyone who has these three things is a mahram. Are we all together? Three things are what makes a person a mahram. Number one is nasab, from the same lineage, meaning he's like your son, for instance, he's from you. And nasab, your son, your son, however far he goes. Your son and whatever comes from your son. That's your nasab, that's yours. Wal abu, your father, wa in ala, and anything that comes from your father. Meaning your father's father. All of those are the woman's mahram. Wal akh, her brother. Whether it be her full brother or half brother, whether brother from the mother or no problem. Brother. Wal am, the uncle. The maternal uncle from your father's side. Wal khal, your uncle from your paternal side and your uncle from your maternal side, from your mother and from your father. Both of them are what? They are your mahram. Wa ibnul akh, your brother's son. Wa ibnul ukht, your sister's son. All of those are nasab. All of that falls under which one? Nasab. The woman, all of those people, she can consider them a mahram and she can be alone with them. The second one is ar-rada'. Ar-rada' is breastfeeding. That the child, that person is a... You were breastfed together. You were not brothers and sisters, like in the mother breastfed. Are we all together? And the condition for that breastfeeding is it has to be before 2 years of age. Because of the ayah, وَالْوَالِدَاتِ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ. And it has to be how many what? خَمْسَ رَضَعَات. Five breastfeedings. Different times. It used to be 10 and it was abrogated. Five. And those five have to be مِنَ الْمَجَاعَة. From hunger. Meaning the child was filled from those five. Because due to hunger. Any child that is breastfed like that, that brother and they become brothers and sisters. So a mother fostered a child, she met all of those conditions, but she already had a son. Okay? She had a son and she breastfed this girl. This girl is now considered what? Akh min al-rada'a, brothers and sisters from breastfeeding. The third mahram is, so that man, boy, he can be a mahram. That brother is a mahram for her. Are we all together? The third one is musahara. Al-musahara. Musahara is the mother of your wife, you're a muhram for her. Your wife's mother, this came because of marriage. You married her daughter. So your wife's mother is your mahram. You're a mahram to her. You can take her to Umrah, you can take her to Hajj, you can be alone with her, no problem. But pay attention. You can only consider the wife's mother a mahram if you've had intimate relationship with her daughter, a contract, a marriage. Are we all together, brothers? But if you did zina with her, no. Or no, it has to be ad-dukhul bin nikah, it has to be by nikah. Okay? Even if you divorce that woman and you go separate ways, that woman's mother is your mother. You can never ever marry her or anything. Are we all together? وَزَوْجُ ابْنَتُهَا وَإِنْ نَزَلْ. Also, the daughter, am I the son of your... If your wife has a daughter, her daughter from another marriage. Are we all together? You marry a woman, she has a what? She has a daughter. You married her mother, the daughter becomes a what? Haram from you. She's like your own daughter now. This daughter came from another previous marriage. This is also musahara. And opposite is the truth. وَهَكَذَا. Those are the three mahrams. Okay? Half. It does now. She breastfed them both. Ha, they both become siblings. Sahih. They do. Now that we've understood what a mahram means, we all know what a mahram means, right? And this is alhamdulillah for us, we already generally know these. We know this. The question here is, if you're not any of that which we mentioned, you're not allowed to be alone with a woman in a room. It's haram. The Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith Uqbah ibn Amir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالدُّخُولَ عَلَى النِّسَى. Do not be alone, or do not enter onto a woman. Here it means don't be alone with the women, because of how the ulama understood the hadith. Don't be alone with a woman. فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ مِّنَ الْأَنصَارِ, a man from the people of Ansari, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, أَفَرَأَيْتَ الْحَمْوَى. What about the husband's brother? You're married, your brother lives with you. So in the morning you leave to work. You go work. And you leave your brother in the house. You leave your brother in the house because you trust your brother, he's your brother. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-hamu mawtun, he's death. Dangerous. It's not that you don't trust your brother, but it's that you don't trust who? You don't trust shaitan. And he's the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam referred to the brother as al-mawtu is because he is the one that you don't most fear from. Death is generally something people just forget. Even though it's there, it's a problem that's there, it's going to happen, generally people are heedless about it. Are we all together? That brother is the one you trust, you say, no problem, come to my house. And shaitan will use any method to destroy the family, to destroy the relationship between you and your brother, and also to destroy the what? The children that come from this and their lineage and who they are and all of that. Now, no, there's nothing. The adopted child is nothing as long as they don't breast. If they breastfeed the child, then it becomes. So here, pay attention with me. So a lot of issues that fall under this is also going into a lift with a woman alone. It falls under al-khalu, being alone. If there's a woman by herself in the lift, just avoid it and you're by yourself. If there's other people with you in the lift, there's no khalu, you can go in. Another man or another woman, two women are in the lift, you can go in if you want to. Are we all together? You and her to go in by yourselves, stay away from it. Some of you might think this is too harsh, the rules of Allah should be made easy. These things, I be very honest with you, the fact that they are not followed and adhered to, you can see what happens in people's problems when they come to me and they ask for solutions of their problems. The things that happen and things that people do, all of it came from this concept of people just mixing and opening the doors for each other. He's my brother, he's my cousin, no problem, speak to my wife. And just freedom. You might be innocent and think, inshallah, khair of everybody. But don't forget shaitan and his role in wanting to destroy things. You have to remember that. Also, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَلَا تُسَافِرُ الْمَرْأَةِ. A woman should not travel إِلَّا مَعَذِي مَحْرَمٍ, except with a mahram. A woman should travel with a mahram. Specifically, the Prophet said alayhi salatu wa salam. Here, if you look at the hadith that Hafiz ibn Hajar chose to bring here, we're talking about Kitab al-Hajj. Are we not talking about Kitab al-Hajj? We're talking about Hajj. Why did he bring it? You'll see soon, it's going to come. Why he brought this hadith specifically to Hajj. وَلَا تُسَافِرُ الْمَرْأَةُ. A woman should not travel إِلَّا مَعَذِي مَحْرَمٍ, except with a mahram. The hadith says a woman should not travel. It did not restrict the duration. Is it 1 day, 2 days, 3 days? So hold on to this hadith. This hadith says that the woman should not travel. That the woman should not what? She should not travel, except with a mahram. There is another hadith that says she should not travel 3 days. There's another hadith, 3 days. And there's another hadith that says, مَسِيرَةَ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ, a day and a night. And there's another hadith which says, she should not travel the duration of a day. Not a night, but a day. Another hadith says, 2 days. Another even narration says, أَكْثَرَ مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ, more than three. Are we all together? How do we bring this all together? We have one hadith that's just saying, no, the woman should not travel except without a mahram. But another narration saying 3 days. Another one saying no, more than 3 days. Another narration saying 2 days. Another narration saying 1 day. Another one saying 1 day and one night. How do we reconcile between all of that, those narrations? Number one, the safest is for the woman never to travel without a mahram, of course. That is al-ahwat, the safest. All together. Because if she takes the 3 days opinion, then what about the hadith that says 2 days? And what about the hadith that says 1 day and one night? And what, wahakada. So the safest is that she doesn't even travel at all without a mahram. That's one response. Number two is, the one who takes the hadith which says don't travel at all will have implemented all of the other hadiths. Sah? In other words, he has taken the hadith of 1 day, the hadith of 1 day and one night, the hadith of 2 days, the hadith of 3 days, or the hadith of 3 days more. All of that he hasn't even traveled. So all of these hadiths, they will be falling under don't travel at all. So why did the Prophet say all these different numbers? He said it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the angle of the person who he was addressing. He believed their duration was this long. I mean, their traveling was this long. Or that they traveled this long. Are we all together? But it wasn't that this is the number. If a person traveled 2 days, he wouldn't say a believer should not travel for 2 days and two nights without a mahram. Because that's what this person did. That's the easiest and the fastest response. And the evidence to show that the traveling without a mahram, are we all together? Even one half a day is not allowed, is this hadith that we're reading right now. How? When the Messenger said a man should not be alone without a woman, A man should not be alone with a woman if he's not her mahram. And a man should not travel, a woman should not travel without a mahram. When the Prophet said that, and he was doing a khutbah, the hadith says, يَخْطُبُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The messenger was doing khutbah, right? A man stood up straight away, who felt that he might have fallen under the prohibition. He said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ يَا messenger of Allah, إِنَّ مْرَأَتِي, my wife, خَرَجَتْ حَاجَّةً, my wife went hajj. وَإِنِّي اكْتُتِبْتُ, and I was written down, I was listed as what? في غزوتي كذا وكذا. I was listed to be in the battle and the army of that and that. I was registered to be in a battlefield. And my wife is now out and she's doing what? Hajj. What shall I do, O Messenger of Allah? The Messenger said, انطلق. Leave this issue of fighting and go to your wife. انطلق فحج مع امرأتك, do Hajj with your wife. Here's a powerful point, which is the messenger, when this man said it, this man, all he heard was وَلَا تُسَافِرُ الْمَرْأَةَ, a woman should not travel إِلَّا مَعَ ذِي مَحْرَمٍ, except with a mahram. That's all that my companion heard, right? And he stood up, he said, Ya Rasulullah, my wife, she's doing hajj. And I'm here, and I have to go to battle so and so. The messenger didn't say to him, hold on, is your wife's hajj obligatory? Is it the first time she's doing it? He didn't question. He also didn't question the duration of his wife's travel. He didn't say, is she traveling for 2 days, 3 days, 1 day? He didn't say anything. Are we all together? He straight away commanded, go and do hajj with your wife. There's a qa'idah now that Imam Shafi'i and great other scholars after that took, which is tarkul istifsali. في مقام الاحتمال ينزل منزلة العموم في المقال. And Iraqi, Abdullah ibn Hajj al-Shanqiti says in his Maraqi al-Su'ud, the 1000 lines in Usul al-Fiqh, ونزلن ترك الاستفصال منزلة العموم في المقال أما في الأقوال. The statement of the messenger in this situation, he never questioned the man. He didn't interrogate him and ask him and say, okay, look, is this your first wife's first hajj? He didn't say that to him. He didn't ask him, how long has your wife been traveling on the road? And how long will she spend on the road? He never asked him this question. And the fact that the messenger didn't question him means all of those, a woman cannot travel without a mahram, even if it's an obligatory hajj. As much as a voluntary hajj. A woman cannot go hajj without a mahram. A hajj which is wajib. Imagine what about traveling for holidays and stuff like that. A woman needs a mahram. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that. Some of the scholars, they said, yes, a woman is not allowed to travel without a mahram. They accepted that because of this hadith. But they said, hajj, which is a pillar of Islam, which is obligatory, which Allah commanded us explicitly, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنْ إِسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. Allah clearly commanded us to do what? Hajj, men and women. How do we then reconcile that command, which is clear-cut and is strong, with the woman not allowed to travel by herself? What about if she has the money? What about she has everything and the ability to try to go? The only thing that's missing from her is what? A mahram. We will then add mahram to the مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. And does it become a condition for the woman? Some scholars said no. She can go. Yes, there are some scholars who said that. From those is Al-Imam Malik. He said that she travels with reliable women and she can go with them. Al-Imam Shafi'i said that as well. Ahmed said in a riwayah anhu, a narration from him. Wa jama'atu min as-salaf. A number of the imams of salaf said that. Walidhalika Al-Imam Shafi'i clearly said, takhruju ma'a thiqatin hurratin muslimah. she will go with a reliable, free woman. Ibn Sirin said, تخرج مع رجل, she would go out with a man, من المسلمين لا بأس به. She can go out with reliable Muslim men and women that are with her, no problem. Auza'i said, تخرج مع قوم عدول. She will go, Auza'i said, she can go out with reliable, honest and truthful people. And the evidence that they used is Bukhari narrated mu'allaqan, mu'allaq. أن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه أذن لأزواجه, that عمر رضي الله عنه mentioned that the Prophet, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he permitted for his wives صلى الله عليه وسلم in the last Hajj in which he did. فبعث معهن, and he sent with them عثمان بن عفان وعبد الرحمن بن عوف. So they said, this is our evidence. And Tahawi narrated an Ibn Hazm with their chain an Nafi' an Ibn Umar, that he said, كان يسافر مع عبد الله. Abdullah ibn Umar, when he would go Hajj, those who would travel with him were مواليات له ليس معهن محرم, women that had no mahrams. All of these are authentically transmitted from Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the dispute, as I said to you, comes from what? This hajj is obligatory. This hajj is what? It's wajib. Okay? And the prohibition of the traveling without a mahram. Ala kulli hal, the action of Abdullah ibn Umar is not easy to say, it's not hard to say, that if a Sahabi goes against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or if any Imam goes against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is given what? More weight in the statement that he said here. Are we all together? But what about the Prophet's action? The fact that he sent his wives with Uthman ibn Affan and who? Abdurrahman ibn Awfin. The scholars, they said 2 points. Number one, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ are ummahat al-mu'mineen. They're the mothers of the believers. Are we all together? And number two is, this is a khususiyah, was a specific issue that the Messenger ﷺ saw permissible. It was permissible for him, sorry. Something that was specific to him, salawatullahi wa sallamun alayhi. I'm not taking away from that this issue is a khilafi issue, a difference of opinion. But I'm strengthening one opinion over the other opinion. The woman should definitely travel with mahrams, with a mahram, for her own safety, for her own well-being, for her to be taken care of. We all know Hajj and how hard it is. Imagine a mother travels by herself and she doesn't have no son to take care of her, or her brother, or a father. It's necessary for that. As for those who say, no problem, the mahram is going to put her on the flight from this place, and on the other side there's another mahram waiting for her. The issue is on the way, on the route. The plane can always divert. It could go to another destination. She might have to spend in another country 3 or 4 days. She could spend a night in another country. Are we all together? Because of the flight going in the opposite direction. So the religion here is to protect the women, to protect them, to take care of them, and to not let them become what? Exposed to stress and hardship and harm. It's there to protect them, not to subjugate them. Now, this hadith, it talks about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had a man. The man was saying, "Labbayka anshu buruma. The word labbaika means, oh Allah, I have obeyed you. And so this man was doing hajj on behalf of Shubruma. Shubruma. So the messenger didn't know who Shubruma was. He said to the man, Man Shubruma? Who is Shubruma? The man goes, Akhul li, is my brother. It's one of my brothers. Oh, qareebul li, or one, or a close relative. Qala, the messenger said to him, Hajajta an nafsika. Did you do hajj from yourself? Did you do hajj first? Did you yourself do hajj? Qala la. The man said no. The messenger said, Hujja an nafsika, do hajj for yourself first. Thumma hujja an shubruma. And then after that, do for shubruma. You yourself haven't even done hajj. First of all, do hajj for yourself and then go out and do hajj for shubruma. Abu Dawud narrated this and Ibn Majah. وَصَحَحُهُ Ibn Hibban. Ibn Hibban authenticated it. This hadith, Hafidh ibn Hajar, he said, وَالرَّاجِحُ عِنْدَ أَحْمَدٍ وَقْفُهُ. According to Al-Imam Ahmed, it's mawquf, meaning, again, it's not attributed to the Prophet. That's the view of Al-Imam Ahmed. But if you go to Subul al-Salam, which is the Sharh al-Bulugh al-Maram by Muhammad Amir al-San'ani, Amir al-San'ani, he brings another opinion for Al-Imam Ahmed, based on the riwayah of his own son, Salih, who said that his father considered this hadith to be the Prophet ﷺ statement. Are we all together? And Amir al-San'ani attributed to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah that Ibn Taymiyyah said that Ahmed ibn Hanbal said this. So we have two views for Imam Ahmed. One view that says that it's mawquf, and another view of Imam Ahmed that says it's what? It's marfu'. It's the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that one seems to be strongest. And the reason why they disputed why it's marfu', why is this attributed to the Prophet, is because the narrator in there, his name is Abdata ibn Sulaiman. Abdata ibn Sulaiman. It's him, the individual, who they say that he attributed it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some scholars, they said he's the one who did it. But he's not alone in doing it. That's the problem with some people. They think he's the only one who did it. No, he's not the only one who did it. Two other people made it marfu' as well, attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with Abda, and that is Muhammad ibn Bishrin, and also Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. So they taba'uhu fi al-raf'i, they agreed with him on the marfu'. As for Abdata ibn Sulaiman, Yahya ibn Ma'in said about him, because Abdata ibn Sulaiman narrated this from who? Sa'id ibn Abi Aruba. He narrated this from Sa'id ibn Abi Aruba. And Yahya ibn Ma'in said a very good statement here. He said, أثبت الناس في سعيد بن أبي عروبة عبدة بن سليمان. The most reliable person when it comes to narrating from سعيد بن أبي عروبة is عبدة بن سليمان. Anyways, this hadith, 10 scholars authenticated it. Ibn Khuzaym authenticated it. Ibn Hibban authenticated it. Bayhaqi authenticated it. An-Nawawi authenticated it. Ibn al-Mulaqqin authenticated it. Ibn Hajar authenticated it. Abd al-Haqq al-Ishbili authenticated it. Ibn al-Qattan authenticated it. Sheikh ibn Baz authenticated it. And also Al-Imam Ahmad riwayatan anhu. One of his views is that it's authentically attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's the evidence, or that's the ruling of this hadith. So the hadith is sahih, inshallah, inshallah ta'ala. It's authentic, inshallah ta'ala. This hadith, as we can see, what we take from it is, if a person hasn't done hajj for himself, that he can't do hajj for someone else, and that he should go and do it for what? For himself, first of all. This is the view of the Shafi'iyyah. The qawlu Shafi'iyyah. Wal Hanabila, and the view of the Hanabila. And there's a specific wording of this hadith that came in Sunan ibn Majah, where the Messenger said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَجْعَلْ هَذِي عَنْ نَفْسِكَ. Make this one that you're doing right now, that you were trying to do for Shubruma, make this one for yourself, and do Hajj for Shubruma another time. And this is the evidence for an issue that the scholars really discuss, which is a person done Hajj, and he thought to do Hajj for someone else. He came with the intention to do Hajj for someone else, okay? Whilst he didn't do Hajj for himself, he has never done Hajj for himself. Whether he finished that Hajj, or whether he's in the middle of that Hajj, they said it automatically becomes his own Hajj. It automatically becomes what? His own Hajj. Why? Because this man was doing Hajj, and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "Faj'al hadhihi," make this one for yourself. Make this one for yourself. Another view said, no, no, no. He intended to do it for someone else. That intention that he'd done for someone else still stands. And this is the qawl of the Hanafi and the Malikiyah. Because they said, if a person hasn't paid debt that was upon him, he never paid his own debt, but he paid for someone else's debt, huh? That person's debt in which he paid for will be accepted, right? He's got debt on him. 1,000 dirhams he took from someone. And he was going to pay for his 1,000 dirhams that he took from someone. He was going to pay it back. On the way, a brother said to him, "Akhi, I've got debt to pay. I'm struggling." And he said, "Okay, I'll pay your debt." With the one that's outstanding for his, can this suffice him? They said, "Yes, of course it can." Like in the other group, they responded and they said, Hajj and the paying of the dain is different. Why? Paying back debt, you don't even need intention. And the debt will still be accepted. Are we all together? If I took debt from someone, and the person calls me and says, "Oh, Akhi, by the way, yesterday when you were in my house, you dropped money, 100 dirhams. And he says to him, "Okay, no problem, keep that 100 dirhams. And that's going to be considered to be what? The loan I gave, the money that I took from you last time. The man already used the money. He never gave it to him to the intention to pay back debt. Debt is not intention. Are we all together? Even if the person doesn't come with an intention to pay back debt, it will still be uplifted from him. Okay? So that's a difference that the scholars respond to. Come back in as-salah. 4 دقائق. Another issue here. The other group, they came back again. They said, remember the story that we took, Qissatul Khath'amiyah, the story of the Khath'ami, the woman who asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she said, "Ya Rasulullah, my father is an old man, he cannot stay in a rainy beast, and can I do Hajj for him?" The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say to her? "Hujji anhu," do Hajj on his behalf. Did he ask her if she did Hajj for herself? Did he? He never asked her whether she done Hajj for herself. He went quiet, he just told her do Hajj. It brings us to the point that we were talking about before, which is تَرْكُ الْإِسْتِصَالِ فِي مَوْضِعِ الْإِحْتِمَالِ يُنَزَّلُ مَنْزِلَةَ الْعُمُومِ فِي الْمَقَالِ, which is the fact that the Messenger didn't ask that Al-Khath'amiyah, that woman, the Messenger didn't ask and say to her, "Have you done Hajj for yourself?" It means that whether she did Hajj for herself or not, they said that it's permissible for her to do Hajj on behalf of someone else. Like in what we say is that hadith is a mafhum. Mafhum. Mafhum is what? It's that which has been understood from it. And this hadith is a mantuq, directly commanding this companion to do Hajj for himself. And the scholars, they say that the direct statement of the Messenger takes precedence, the mantuq takes precedence over the mafhum. Are we all together? Because here he clearly instructed this companion to do Hajj for himself first, and then after it should do it for the Shubruma. Like in the other hadith of Qisatul Khath'amiyah, it's a mafhum, it's an understanding, a possibility that he didn't, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, explain it to her. It's an understanding that was taken from it. It's an interpretation that's taken out of it. We give precedence to the mantuq in this hadith. Another point that I want to mention, inshallah, I'm going to conclude with that is, this hadith shows that you can do hajj on behalf of a close relative, a brother, and even a close relative. It doesn't have to be your blood brother. It doesn't have to be. And it also shows that the person can be alive or the person can be dead. It doesn't matter, it's the same. Whether they are alive or whether they are dead. This hadith Ibn Abbas, some scholars, they weakened it. But the scholars that authenticated it are a lot in number. And the scholars that authenticated it are Al-Imamu Al-Hakim Al-Naysaburi, he authenticated it. Al-Imamu Al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah, he agreed with Hakim in his grading. عبد الحق الإشبيلي الإمام النووي رحمه الله أحمد شاكر الألباني رحمه الله تعالى الشيخ مقبل بن هادي الوادعي الشيخ أبو إسحاق الحويني in his كتاب غوث المقدود they all graded this hadith to be صحيح and Tirmidhi narrated it from two other companions the first one is علي بن أبي طالب and Anas ibn Malik. So there's three companions in total. I'm not 100% sure that Tirmidhi narrated Anas ibn Malik, but if my memory serves me correct, I think he mentions it there. If it serves me right, I think he said it there, Tirmidhi. The hadith is, خَطَبَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ The messenger done a khutbah for us. فَقَالَ The messenger said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ The word كَتَبَ is two types. When you find it in the Quran, يَا يَلَذِينَ عَمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كِتَابَ شَرْعِيَّةً which means this has been prescribed for you in the Sharia. It has been made obligatory on in the Sharia. And that's the one that is referring to here. It's كِتَابَ شَرْعِيَّةً meaning Allah has written in the Sharia, Allah has obliged and made it obligatory in the Sharia that the people do Hajj. And there's another type of Kitaba which is called Kitaba Qadariya. Allah universally makes things happen. But that's not what this hadith is talking about, because if it was, then everybody would be doing Hajj if it was Kitaba Qadariya. If it was a universal, then that would mean Allah would make everybody go and do Hajj. No, that's not what it means here. It means that everyone is made obligatory to do Hajj. So the messenger said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحَجَّ Allah made Hajj obligatory on you. فَقَامَ الْأَقْرَعِ ibn حَابِسٍ A noble companion, الْأَقْرَعِ ibn حَابِس, he stood up. And he said, أَفِي كُلِّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَفِي كُلِّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولَ Every year, O Messenger of Allah, did we have to do Hajj every year? The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لَوْ قُلْتُهَا If I was to say yes, لَوَجَبَتْ It would have been obligatory on you. الْحَجُّ مَرَّةٌ Hajj is only once. فَمَا زَادَ فَهُوَ تَطَوُّعُ And anything that goes beyond that once is voluntary. How do we reconcile between this and the statement of Allah, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ And some of you might think that there's no problem here. There could be brought out an ishkal here. But it's easy to respond to it. Someone might say, the messenger said, لَوْ قُلْتُهَا لَوَجَبَتْ If I was to say it's obligatory, then it would have been obligatory. But what we know is that the Messenger ﷺ takes the obligation from who? From Allah. So he attributed it to what? Himself. When in reality it's from who? From Allah. The scholars responded to that easily. They said, as we know, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did sometimes respond with ijtihad. He would say things based on his ijtihad. If this ijtihad was right and there was nothing wrong with it, the Quran and the Sunnah will, Allah will not correct him. And so then it will be a revelation from Allah. It goes in line with what Allah wanted. Are we all together? And that's the one the Messenger is referring to. لَوْقُلْتُ هَلَ وَجَبَتْ If I was to say it for myself, it would go in line with what Allah wants and it would have been obligatory on you. And another type is that the Messenger ﷺ says it from himself and he gets it wrong and he gets corrected. Either way, whether you look at it from him saying it from himself and not being corrected, or for him being corrected, both times when it reaches the people, it's a what? It's a revelation from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are we all together? Does that make sense? So this hadith says, لو قلتها, if I was to say it, لوجبت, it would have become obligatory on you. الحج مرة, حج is once. فما زاد فهو تطوع. And anything beyond that is a تطوع. Here's a question. Why did Hafidh ibn Hajar place a hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi and Abu Dawood and Nasa'i and Ahmed narrated it? Because he said Rawah al-Khamsa. The Khamsa he's referring to here is, he means the four Sunan exclude Tirmidhi. How many are you left with? Abu Dawood and Nasa'i and Ibn Majah, and the other one is what? Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. So it's Abu Dawood, Al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Ahmed. Are we all together? So the five that he mentions at the beginning of the book exclude Tirmidhi, is four. So are we all together? Those are the four that narrated it. Here the question is, these four that narrated it, which is Abu Dawood, Ibn Majah, Al-Nasa'i, and Ahmed, their book is not as high as Bukhari and Muslim, correct? Bukhari and Muslim is the highest. Why did Ibn Hajar mention the Muslim's version after he mentioned one that some scholars have questioned his authenticity? Because he says after that, وَأَصْلُهُ فِي مُسْلِمٍ مِنْ حَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةِ This was in Sahih Muslim. And it's on the authority of Abu Hurairah. And this one is authentic. No one questioned his authenticity. It made more sense for him to put that one first, right? But why did he put this one first? The scholars, they responded to that is because there's a wording in this version that's not found in the version of Al-Imam Muslim, which gives it more meaning. And that is the wording, فَمَا زَادَ فَهُوَ تَطَوُّعُ And anything more than that, it's voluntary, is not found in the Muslim's version. So he put it there because of a fiqh benefit that he wants to get for you. Are we all together? Also, the hadith, it benefits us. The Hajj is once in your lifetime. You don't have to do Hajj every single year. Once is enough. And every person. And anything after that, you get rewarded for it, you get ajr for it, and it's good to do it. Especially if your first time was not very good. It's best to do it again and again and again. If Allah gave you the money, then you should do it every year. Some of the Salaf, rahimahumullah, they did it 40 years. Consecutively. 40 years they were doing Hajj. Are we all together? So it's good to do that. And this, the scholars they say, it is min taysir illahi ta'ala, how Allah wants to make things easy for us. Wa rahmatihi, how merciful He is to His slaves. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine we had to do Hajj every year. It would be very hard on us. The money, the traveling, the But Allah make it once. So this deen is a what? إِنَّ الدِّينَ يُسْرٌ وَلَنْ يُشَادَّ الدِّينَ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا غَلَبَهُ فَسَدِّدُوا وَقَارِبُوا This religion is easy. It's easy. No one makes it hard on the people and makes this religion so complicated and so hard to the people that they can't do it. except that you will find that the person himself will overcome him. And a lot of the time, those people themselves cannot implement the religion anymore. They can't do it because they were saying everything haram, this haram, that haram, this. And so later, he's a human. He's going to fall short, and then he leaves the religion because he can't keep up with the hard rules that is placed around him. Are we all together? So this deen is yusrun, simplicity. But there's a difference between what the sharia made easy and following your desires. And that's a lecture for another time. Are we all together? Now we're going to go into the chapter of Bab al-Muwaqit. The chapter of al-Muwaqit. Al-Muwaqit is fixed time and fixed places for ihram. Mawaqit is jama', it's a plural. This is a benefit that you need to write. Al-Muwaqit is a plural. And the singular is miqat. Miqat is the singular. The miqat is two types. The mawaqit are two types. Miqat zamaniya. And a miqat which is makaniya. What does it mean, miqat zamaniya? Hajj, it's on particular months. Didn't Allah not say al-hajju ashhurun ma'lumat? Al-hajju ashhurun ma'lumat. Hajj is at an appointed time. It's at a particular time. What months is Hajj on? The first one is Shawwal. Shawwal is Ashhur al-Hurum. Are we all together? Shawwal. Dhul-Qa'dah. Those two, the scholars unanimously agree, those 2 months, Shawwal and Dhul-Qa'dah, all of it is Ashhur al-Hurum. All of it. Lakin they differed in Dhul-Hijjah. Is all of it, or is it only the first 10 days? Are we all together? And the overwhelming majority of the scholars are of the opinion, well, is that it's only the first 10. Does that make sense? Those are called Ashhur al-Hurum. Those are called Ashhur al-Hajj, the Hajj months. This is Miqat Zamaniya, the timing. Are we all together? And this is important that you know this. That when these months enter, it's the month of Hajj. The period of Hajj has started. Are we all together? Because we're going to see later why it's important to know these months. That's the first time. The second one is Miqatun Makaniya. Makaniya means place. The other one was timing. And this is Miqat Makaniya, places. And we're going to see five miqats. Four is going to be mentioned in the first hadith of Ibn Abbas, and the other one is going to be mentioned in the hadith to come after that. Hadith Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Five miqats. Each people, their miqat. Are we all together? What does miqat mean here? It means there it's places located where the person cannot come to do Hajj unless he stops here, or Umrah, unless he stops here and he comes with the intention. Naam. This hadith, Bukhari and Muslim both narrated it. Ghayatul Siha. The hadith says, waqqata li ahli al-Madinah. Waqqata, what does it mean? Ja'ala miqatan. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he specified for the people of Medina. The word waqqata comes from the word waqt, a tahdeed, he specified. You can specify something in timing and you can specify something in place. Miqat, that's what it means. So the Messenger specified for the people of Medina a place called Dhul Hulayfa. That's their miqat. That's the place they go to. Are we all together? And they wear their ihram there, they come with their intention, and etc. Dhul Hulayfa today is known as Abyar Ali. If you go to Dhul Hulayfa today, it's known as Abyar Ali. Abyar Ali is what they call it. And the people of Medina, this is where they come from. This is their miqat. And the reason why it's called Abyar Ali is because there was a well over there. Okay? And they say that well, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he fought with the jinns. That Ali fought with the jinns. وَأَذَا كَذِبُ لَا أَصْلَ لَهُ. That's all lies, there's no basis for it. There's no authentic sources for that. But it's called Abyar Ali if you go there. So there's a well there, and the reason why they call it Abyar is because there's a well there, and there's also Ali, they say, that fought against the jinns over there, which has no base for it. The five miqats that we're going to talk about, Dhul Hulayfa is Ab'adul Mawaqid, the furthest from Mecca. All the five, the miqat of Medina is the furthest. Dhul Hulayfa is the furthest from Mecca. It's actually 11 kilometers from Medina, the Prophet's Masjid, or Medina, because it's not in Medina, it's outside Medina. And it's 420 kilometers from Mecca. From Mecca. So that's, we now know the first miqat. For who? If you're in Medina and you want to go Hajj or you want to go Umrah, Dhul Hulayfa. The second one is Wali Ahli Sham. Ahli Sham, when you hear the word Sham, it's referring to four lands, four countries. Syria, Lebanon, Urdun, which is Jordan, and Palestine. Those four countries, they all fall under Sham. Are we all together? In English it's called Levant, right? Levant, Sham, those four. For the people of Sham, their miqat is Juhfa. Al-Juhfa. So if anybody comes from Palestine, or comes from Lebanon, or Urdun, Jordan, or comes from Syria, their miqat is Juhfa. Juhfa. The Messenger prescribed. All of these miqat that I'm mentioning, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam picked those miqats. This was Hajjatul Wada'. Hajjatul Wada'. The last Hajj that the Prophet did, this is when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it. Its distance between Mecca and Juhfa is 186 kilometers, approximately. And if you take the road that they call Tariq al-Sari', it's fast. You can get there very quick. And recently they built over there a masjid. You'll find it there. Now we know for the people of Sham, Juhfa. What about the people of Najd? Najd is Riyadh and anything that lines up with that direction. Qasim, Ha'il, all of those lands. It's all what? Najd. But like Saudi Arabia is broken into two, right? Najd and Hijaz. Najd is Riyadh and all of this and that. And Hijaz is Mecca and Medina and Ta'if and and Jeddah or Jeddah or Jeddah, however you want to say it. Are we all together? That's Hijaz. And this is Najd. So the people of Najd, it's for them is Qarnul Manazil. For the people of Najd is Qarnul Manazil. It's what? Qarnul Manazil. And the distance between it and Mecca is 87 kilometers تقريبا. ولأهل اليمن. And the people of Yemen. For them is, why are they called Yemen? The reason the scholars, they say it's called Yemen is because it's Yaminu, it's on the right side, Yemen, Yamin, the right side of Mecca, of the Kaaba. That's why Yemen is called Yamin, it's on the right side of Mecca. Are you with me? And so they are on the side of the black stone. Are we all together? The black stone faces towards Yemen. And the opposite of the Kaaba, the other side of the Kaaba, opposite to the black stone, it faces towards Sham. So that's why it's called Yemen. It's on the right side of the Kaaba. Their one is called Yalamlam. Their one is, the people of Yemen, is Yalamlam. Hunna lahunna, the messenger said. For all of those people, that's their miqat. Good. Hunna lahunna, that's for them. The messenger explained it to all to you. What about the people who are inside Mecca? Or they're not in Mecca, but they're also before the miqat. They have to drive backwards to the miqat, or can they just go forward to Mecca? The messenger told us. He said, وَلِمَنْ أَتَى عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ غَيْرِهِنَّ. Sorry, before that, okay. وَمَنْ كَانَ دُونَ ذَلِكَ فَمِنْ حَيْثُ أَنْشَأَ. And anyone who's besides that, then wherever he is where he starts it from. He doesn't have to go back to the miqat. Are we all together? وَمَنْ كَانَ دُونَ ذَلِكَ. And anyone who's besides the miqat, he's in Jeddah. Are we all together? That's not in Mecca, but it's outside Mecca, but it's also before the miqat. There's no miqat that can get it. Do they have to go backwards? No. وَمَنْ كَانَ دُونَ ذَلِكَ. And anyone who is other than that, فَمِنْ حَيْثُ أَنْشَأَ. فَمِيقَاتُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَنْشَأَ. His miqat is wherever he starts off from. Even the people of Mecca. A person in Mecca, who lives in Mecca, where's his ihram from his household? Are we all together? Okay. The hadith also says, وَلِمَنْ أَتَى عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ غَيْرِهِنَّ. What about if a person goes to Medina, but he's from Yemen. From Yemen. But he goes to Medina. Does he have to do ihram from Yalamlam, where he's originally from and where he's, or does he do it from Dhul Hulayfa, the miqat of the people of Medina? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he does it from what? Where he is. He does it from Yemen. Sorry, he does it from Medina. He does it from, he's not forced to go back to the miqat of his original land. And that commonly happens. Some people, they travel to Medina, they don't take the miqat, they actually go to Medina, and when they go to Medina and they land, then they go to Dhul Hulayfa. Then they do Hajj from there. And when they land in Medina, what are they doing? When they go to Medina, they don't wear ihram or anything. Are we all together, brothers? These people, they can do that. Their miqat becomes the miqat of the people of Medina. They can do the miqat of the people of Medina. And they're not told, go back, your miqat is not this, you're originally from what country did you come from? Oh, you came from this country, then go back to your miqat. None of that is said to the person. How many miqat did the Prophet ﷺ mention here? These four, the scholars unanimously agree, ijma', that the messenger prescribed these four. The fifth one, which we're going to see soon, there's a dispute. Was it the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who prescribed it? Or was it someone other than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? There's a khilaf. We'll look at that. Inshallah ta'ala, it's the next hadith after this. It's the next hadith after this. So what did the hadith show us? That the places where the miqat are four places, a person should not go over those four places. If he wants to go Umrah or Hajj, you don't go over these places. You can't pass through these places. Why? If you do that, then this falls under تعدي حدود الله عز وجل. You're exceeding Allah's boundaries, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's important. Ibn al-Mundhir, he transmitted an ijma' that if a person does it before the miqat, and I have to speak about this issue because it's very important. Some of us, we come by, well, all of us do. We all come by plane. Okay? And on the plane, we go over the miqat fast. No plane's going to stop at the miqat and allow you to go in and do your... No, it'll go over. Two issues arises from this. Number one, the people who are the pilot is not a Muslim, and so in the Sharia's eyes, he's not mahalu thiqa. His words are not strong in our religion. That doesn't mean he's a liar, but it just means it doesn't carry weight. Are we all together? So if he announces that you're going over the miqat, he's not mahalu thiqa aslan. He's not trusted. That's one. Whether he's truthful or not, and whether he's the most honest person, it's not the point. It's just that in the Sharia, he's not taken. Number two, even if he was a Muslim that was announcing it, or you saw it on the screen in front of your seat, on planes they show you where you are, the miqat is fast. Before you probably get off your chair, boom, everything's done. Are we all together? So you may not be able to what? To get in time to where you're haram. So are you allowed to do it before you leave in the airport? Yes, you can. Are we all together? I would personally push that if a person to try to unite the two and try to do both as much as they can, is that if they wear their ihram. And maybe wear their shoes or their boxes or whatever, some clothes, which still doesn't. And whenever it's announced or whenever they see it, then that's when they take their shoes off, or they take off the clothes that they are wearing that are not allowed to be done Hajj or Umrah with. And then he does his talbiyah, he doesn't get off his chair. Are we all together? That would be better in the sense where he combines between not doing it before the miqat, and also not losing the chance of what? Of missing the miqat. And Imam Ibn al-Mundhir, he brought an ijma' that if the person does it before the miqat, his umrah and his hajj is correct. There's nothing wrong with it. And there's many sahabas who said this, Ali ibn Abi Talib and many companions. Ibn Hazm, he said, إِنَّهُ لَا يَجُوزُ, it is not permissible. You cannot do it before the miqat. This is the view of Ibn Hazm. And it's narrated from Ibn Ishaq, the same thing. Another thing that we take from this hadith is there's a benefit here, which is how the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his mu'jiza, how Allah showed him that all of these lands are going to become a Muslim land. These places are all going to be under the Muslims. Remember, at his time, all of this was not. They were in the hands of the non-Muslims. And he prophesied that these are the places where it's going to be the miqat. This is a prophecy, he prophesies, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that they're going to be, he prophesied, you all know Sham, right? Sham was not open at the time of the Messenger. He said the people of Sham, he knows that they're going to become Muslims when they take Islam. Are we all together? Here, when he says Sham, what is he talking about? Palestine, Bayt al-Maqdis. He knows they're going to come into Islam. Lebanon, Urdun, Syria, all of this. They are not Muslims. He said, Ahlul Sham, this is their place. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another benefit that we take from the hadith is anyone who's in Mecca, they do the ihram from Mecca. And he doesn't go to a miqat. The question here is this for Hajj and Umrah, or is it only for Hajj and not Umrah? The scholars, they said that this hadith, it states both, correct? Hajj and Umrah. But there's another evidence that takes Umrah out of the equation. And that is what? When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his wife Aisha, he told her, go, because remember when she came, her menstruation happened to her. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, everybody's going to go out back with Hajj and Umrah, and I'm going to go back with no Hajj and no Umrah. So the Messenger said, okay, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr, her brother, he said, take her to the outskirts of Mecca. Take her where? Take her to the outskirts of Mecca. Today that place they call it Tad'ib, right? Or Masjid Aisha. Why do they call it Masjid Aisha? Because of this situation. So she went with her brother Abdurrahman. They stopped there. They came back in to Mecca again. And she did Umrah. So why didn't she do her intention of Umrah in Mecca? Why was she told to leave? Why was her brother and her told to leave? That shows that Umrah is not the issue. Okay, Umrah is different. And the hadith of Aisha came after which one? This hadith that we have. Okay? That's important to understand. Naam. This hadith, this one now talks about the fifth miqat that we said that was made. Which one? How many miqats did we say there were? Five, and this is the fifth one. There's a discussion. Who was the first person to do it? Who did the miqat for the people of Iraq? Some of the scholars, they say it was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and some of them said what? It was Umar ibn al-Khattab. This hadith, it says, and Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, and then Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam waqqata li ahli al-Iraq, that the messenger, he specified for the people of Iraq that irqin. He specified for them that irq. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rawahu Abu Dawood. Abu Dawood narrated this. Wa nasa'iyu an al-imam al-nasa'iyu. Here some scholars, they weakened this hadith. They weakened it. I'm going to mention four scholars who weakened it. Al-imam al-Shafi'i, he weakened it. And al-imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he weakened this hadith. And Imam Muslim Ibn Hajjaj, He weakened it. And Ibn Khuzaymah, he weakened it. They all weakened it. And the reason they weakened it is because a narrator in there whose name is Aflah ibn Humayd. They said Aflah ibn Humayd, he went alone with this hadith. And so Imam Ahmad, he called this hadith Munkar. And Imam Muslim said, Ruya min tariqi. This hadith is narrated from a chain, مَنْ لَا يُقْبَلُ تَفَرُّدُهُ. A person who, him being alone is never accepted. They won't be accepted from him. 11 scholars authenticated it like him. 11. First one is Ibn Sakan. Ibn Sakan authenticated it. Abdul Haqq al-Ishbili authenticated it. And Imam al-Nawwi authenticated it. Ibn Kathir authenticated it. Ibn Taymiyyah authenticated it. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi authenticated it. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani authenticated it. Zainuddin al-Iraqi authenticated it. Muhammad Ali al-Shawkani authenticated it. Muhammad Amir al-San'ani authenticated it. And Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani authenticated it. Ibn Mundhir responded back to Ibn Khuzaymah. Ibn Mundhir rahimahullah, he responded back to Ibn Khuzaymah. Ala kulli hal, I myself looked at it quickly but didn't reach a conclusion. But my heart leans for now to the authentication of the hadith. It leans towards that. And the only reason is because this hadith, as Hafiz Mahajir, look what he mentioned here. What did he say? He said, وَأَصْلُ عِنْدَ مُسْلِمٍ. This wording, this narration of Abu Dawood and Nasa'i is found in Sahih Muslim. مِنْ حَدِيثِ جَابِرٍ. The hadith of Jabir, which we're going to see inshaAllah ta'ala. إِلَّا أَنَّ رَاوِيَهُ شَكَّ فِي رَفْعِهِ. Except that the narrator, he became doubtful of whether it can be attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Are we all together? So he doubted it. And if he doubted it, and we have another narration that's clear cut, they support each other. Because the qa'idah is man hafidha hujjatun ala man lam yahfad. The one who knows and memorizes is a proof against the one who hasn't. So the narration that attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes precedence over the questioned or the one that the narrator is doubtful regarding it. And the narrator that's doubtful here in the hadith of Jabir in Sahih Muslim is Abu Zubayr al-Makki. Is who? Abu Zubayr al-Makki, as Al-Qadi Iyad mentioned. So it is marfu' inshaAllah ta'ala. And this hadith, what does it show us? That the one who chose for the people of Iraq the miqat is who? The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. If the hadith is sahih to you, then you would believe that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam is the one who chose the miqat for the people of Iraq. If you believe that those narrations are weak, then you're going to accept the one to come after, which is wa fil Bukhari, and in Sahih al-Bukhari is anna Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Umar is the one huwa alladhi waqqata dhata 'irqin. Umar was the one who appointed, and he was the one who chose the dhatu 'irq for the people of Iraq when he was questioned. So how do we reconcile between the narration in Sahih al-Bukhari, which clearly says, and it's no weakness in it, everyone agrees, Bukhari saying, and he specifically chose this one, Bukhari, that Umar is the one who did the miqat for the people of that Irqin, for the people of Iraq. How do you reconcile between that one and the other narration that's saying that the messenger did it, alayhi salatu wasalam? It's easy. That when Umar prescribed it for the people of Iraq, he didn't know it. He didn't know it. And he done it from his own ijtihad. He did it from his own personal independent reasoning. He looked and he observed, and he looked at the distance and whatever miqat is level to it, and he specifically chose that irqin. And we will call this, like we've called other issues, Muwafaqatu Umar. Umar, many times he gave verdicts and he went in the line of the Quran and the Sunnah, did it not? It went in line with the Quran. So we'll say this is min Muwafaqatu Umar. As for Shaykh Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan in his Sharh Munhaj al-A'lam, all of these arguments, he doesn't accept it. And he says that's not a strong argument, because he said that for this miqat to be hidden from Umar radiallahu anhu, and it's not an apparent knowledge for everyone, and the people asked Umar, and not one person pointed it out and said, Umar, the messenger already said it. Huh? They said this is what? Is questionable, but it's not, it can't be, لأن we know that the memorization of the Sunnah in its totality is not present for nobody. It isn't. على كل حال, this is inshallah ta'ala, that it came from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he, mashallah, it happened that his fatwa and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he already said, went hand in hand with each other. نعم.
وعند أحمد وأبي داود والترمذي عن ابن عباس أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقت لأهل المشرق العظيم.
That hadith, sorry, I never mentioned that one. وعند أحمد وأبي داود والترمذي عن ابن عباس أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقت لأهل المشرق العقيق. That hadith of Ibn Abbas, that Ahmad narrated, and Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi, from the chain of Yazid ibn Abi Ziyad, and Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas an jaddihi bihi wa qala Tirmidhi wa hadha hadithun hasan. This hadith is weak for two reasons. It's weak for two reasons. The first one is, in the chain is Yazid ibn Abi Ziyad, and he's a person whose narration is avoided. Yazid ibn Abi Ziyad, because of him the chain is avoided. And the second reason is that Muhammad ibn Ali, who's in the chain as well, it is not known. لا يعلم له سماع من ابن عباس. There's no evidence to show that he heard from Ibn Abbas. ولا أنه لقيه أو رآه. And there's no evidence to show that he even met him or saw him. So for those two reasons, it's weak. Sheikh Al-Albani brought a third reason, and he said that the hadith is munkar, because Yazid ibn Abi Ziyad, he opposed others. And a weak person, when he opposes others, his hadith is called what? Munkar. So Sheikh Nasir gave a third reason. Anyways, there are two scholars who authenticated this hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas. The first one is Al-Imam Tirmidhi, and Tirmidhi is wrong in that. And the second one is Ahmad Shakir. And Ahmad Shakir, as it's well known by the scholars, is that he had tasahul. He's very lenient when it came to hadiths. There are many people that were weak that he strengthened, like Ibn Lahi'a and Hajjaj ibn Artat that we mentioned yesterday, and Yazid ibn Abi Ziyad and Abdul Rahman al-Ifriqi and others. Ahmad Shakir, he would just authenticate them. So he had no tasahul in him. Lakin, nine scholars weakened his hadith. Al-Imam al-Nawawi weakened his hadith. Al-Imam al-Mundiri weakened the hadith. Al-Bayhaqi weakened it. Ibn al-Qattan weakened it. Ibn Kathir weakened it. Ibn Mulaqin weakened it. Ibn Hajar weakened it. Al-Albani weakened it. Shu'ayb al-Arnaut weakened it. Those imams, they weaken this hadith. So because it's weak, there is no basis for it. There's no need for us to go over it. It's weak. Naam. This hadith, Bukhari and Muslim both narrated it. This is a hadith which is sahih. The chapter here is called Babu Wujuhil Ihrami. This chapter, it talks about the types of ihram. How many types of ihram are there? Three. We will talk about it. Al-Tamattu', Al-Qiran, and Al-Ifrad. We're going to talk about it, inshallah. The three types of hajj. We're going to talk about that. Now we're going to go into, we spoke about the miqat. We also touched deeply on the issue of miqat, right? Now we're going to go into the different types of hajj. You want to go hajj this year? What type of hajj shall I do? Which one is the best hajj? With why? And etc. So there are three types of hajj. And so we're going to talk about it. And in this chapter we're going to talk about the sifah. وَصِفَتِهِ The characteristics and the way to do the ihram. The way of ihram. نعم. Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها, she said, خرجنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. We went out with the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. عام حجة الوداع. Who knows what year the Hajjat al-Wada' was? In Islamic Hijriya calendar? Yeah. When was Hajjat al-Wada'? Yeah? Na'am, the 10th. It was on the 10th year. Are we all together? It was on the 10th year. Sanat al-Ashirat min al-Hijrah. فَمِنَّا مَنْ أَهَلَّ بِعُمْرَةٍ So the narrator is now going to go into what they did. فَمِنَّا From amongst us is مَنْ أَهَلَّ بِعُمْرَةٍ The word أَهَلَّ means رَفْعُ الصَّوْت, is when you raise your voice. And the reason why it comes from the word أَهَلَّ, it comes from the word هِلَال. You know the هِلَال is a crescent. Generally, when the people see the crescent, they say, Allah, the crescent, they raise their voice to tell others. That's where it's taken from. فَمِنَّا مَنْ أَهَلَّ بِعُمْرَةٍ From amongst us were those who done umrah, ihram, we done a umrah. What type is that one? That's نَوْعُ الْأَوَّلْ مِنْ أَنْوَاعِ النُّسُكِ That's the first type of the types of the nusuk, which is a tamattu'. What does it mean? The person does tamattu' means the person does umrah. He goes and he does umrah. And then when he does umrah, so he goes to the miqat and he has the intention to do umrah. And it's in what month does he do that umrah in? في أشهر الحج. Any time within that month. Those months, sorry, Shawwal, Dhul Qi'dah, all together. Any time he does it within that time is a what? He does Umrah then. After that, he's in Tamattu'. If you go to Mecca at that time and you do Umrah, you have to do Hajj. We're going to talk about that and the discussion regarding that. Of course, if the person hasn't done Hajj before. Whether he does Hajj before and he has to do it, we're going to talk about that as well, inshallah ta'ala. So it means the person comes with Umrah. Is everyone with me? Because this information is very important. The person comes to the miqat with Umrah in his mind. He does Umrah. He says in the miqat, Labbayka Umrah. That's what he says. Once he finishes Umrah, he takes off his clothes, his Umrah clothes, he shaves his hair, and he does what he wants to do. Has relationship with his wife, he cuts his nails, he normal, but he's in Mecca. He doesn't leave. Yawmu Tarwiyah. Yawmu Tarwiyah is what? On the 8th. On the 8th, he goes for Hajj. From where like him? From Mecca. He doesn't have to go outside. That's called At-Tamattu'. Are we all together, brothers? Very good. The second one is Aisha saying, "Waminna and from amongst us were those people man ahalla bi hajjatin wa umrah." Yeah. Everyone's going to Hajj that day. It's the Hajj starting now. It's Yawm al-Tarwiyah, everyone's going to go. Is it wajib? Is it not? We'll talk about that inshallah ta'ala. But it's the Hajj started. Okay? The second one is وَمِنَّا مَنْ أَهَلَّ بِحَجَّةٍ وَعُمْرَةٍ Aisha said, and from amongst us were those who did Hajj and Umrah together. This is the second type of nusuk. Which is what? The person comes to the miqat with the intention of Hajj and Umrah simultaneously. This is called Qiran. It's called what? Al-Qiran. And the person stays in that state even after they finish Umrah, and they cannot get out of that state until Yawm Tarwiyah. Are we all together? They stay away from sexual intercourse, they stay away from this. Are we all together? Until Hajj. Are we all together? وَمِنَّا and from amongst us is مَنْ أَهَلَّ بِحَجْ. And the second one, the third one is some of us who just came for Hajj. وَهُوَ الْإِفْرَاد. It's the third type, which is إِفْرَاد. No Umrah, just Hajj. Person comes just to do Hajj. So he comes with the intention of Hajj from the Miqat. And he says, لَبَّيْكَ لَبَّيْكَ حَجًّا. After that, Aisha said, وَأَهَلَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. What was the last one we just mentioned right now? I want you to all focus on me, because we're going to go in a bit technical now. Oh, we were always going technical. Yeah. Please, brothers, pay attention, because this is the vital information that you need to know. Some of the points I mentioned of the authentication of the hadith may not necessarily be important to you, but this one's important for you to know. Which was the last one that we just mentioned right now? Al-Ifrad. What was Ifrad? Only Hajj. After that, if you look at the hadith, it says, وَأَهَلَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ بِالْحَجِّ. And the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he did Hajj. So what does it come across? What does it seem like from this hadith? That the Messenger did the third what type, right? Al-Ifrad. And what is authentic is that the Messenger did which Hajj that year? Here, another view. Al-Qira, another view. Huh? I mean, you can't say Ifrad because that's out of the picture. So it's either Qiran or At-Tamattu. The Prophet did Qiran. Are we all together, brothers? That was what the Prophet did. So how do we take this hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, where she said, and evidence to show that the Prophet did Qiran is this hadith, where the Messenger said, Atani laylata atin. Someone came to me, an angel came to me. Min Rabbi, from my Lord. فَقَالَ, he said to me, صَلِّ فِي هَذَا الْوَادِ الْمُبَارَكِ. Pray in this blessed valley. To Nabi Muhammad. Pray in this blessed valley. وَقُلْ, and say, عُمْرَةٌ فِي حَجَّةٍ. Umrah with Hajj. Which one was Umrah with Hajj? Qiran. And the hadith is clear. It's crystal clear. It's in Sahih al-Bukhari. So the Messenger did what? One of the good books I read on this, it's really little, but it's very good. It's written by a sheikh who lives here, Sheikh Khalid Ismail. He has a little risala on the issue of the three nusuk. He gave it to me, and I just put it in my library, and subhanAllah, books are always valuable. I just read it last night, properly. I read it before, quickly, tasafuh. But he talks about which one is virtuous, which one is better, which one did the Prophet do, and etc. And he reconciles between those hadiths. So, how do we reconcile between this one and a hadith of Aisha here? It's easy to reconcile. What we say is, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at the beginning, he was doing Al-Ifrad. The beginning. That was his intention. And then he put after that, the angel came to him and told him, he added what? He added Umrah to it. That's the response which is mentioned by Ibn al-Mundhir and Ibn Hazm and Ibn Hajar. Are we all together? And another evidence to show that the Prophet ﷺ, when he came, Na'am. Okay. So that's the evidence for the Prophet ﷺ doing qiran. So how many hajjis do we have? Those three. Which one from those three did the Prophet do? Qiran. Which one is the best one? Put your hand up if you believe the tamattu is the best. Put your hand up if you believe al-qiran is the best. And put your hand up if you believe al-ifrad is the best. No one. No one chose that one. Okay, question. Put your hands up the ones who said tamattu. Ha. The tamattu brothers. Listen to this question. Are you guys saying Allah prescribed for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam something which is less virtuous? That Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that which is less in virtue? We want a response from you, brothers. Because ayah says, أَتَسْتَبِدِنُونَ الَّذِي هُوَ أَدْنَى بِالَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ. Something which is high. Prophet take a lesser. While you guys are thinking about that question, the tamattu brothers, let me go to the qiran brothers. The qiran brothers, where would you take the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he said, لَوْ اسْتَقْبَلْتُ مِنْ أَمْرِي. If I could go back in time, Qiran brothers, are you listening? The messenger said to the Qiran, sorry, he said, if I could go back on my affairs, مَسْتَدْبَرْتُ, I would not have taken another opinion. لَسُقْتُ الْهَدْيَ وَلَجَعَلْتُ عُمْرَةً. I would have done tamattu. Nabiullah Muhammad said, I would have done tamattu. Those two ishkal need to be responded to. Hiya. Faddal Abu Salih. What's your answer? The Prophet Allah wanted to show that the Quran is allowed. The question that's on the tamattu is, did the messenger do that which is less virtuous? Tamattu. Did the Prophet ﷺ regret a good action that he was doing? The reward will be the same. Okay. So both of them are virtuous. None of them. No.
For tamattu, the response would be the hadith which you mentioned.
Uh-huh.
Said that if I would do that next time. Right?
Okay.
So that would be my response if I'm saying
that. Okay. Muhammad. Good.
If the Prophet had known at the time that tamattu was permissible.
If he was to know, okay. So he didn't know that tamattu was permissible before. That the ruling of tamattu maybe came later. Yeah. Any other answers that anyone else wants to put in? Homework for tomorrow, inshallah. I want people to go in, research it, look at it, and let's bring it to the table, inshallah. Because if I give it to you easily now, you will not know why. Easy come, easy go. Huh? If it comes easy, if I just say this one's better, you will remember it when you go Hajj, but you can get help. Look for it.
It could be that because there was no break and the people were with him, he should observe everything from start to finish without a break. So I can think of that.
Okay.
It's possible that they only knew about Tamattu and Ifrad, but then the angel came to reveal to him that you can also do Qiran.
So the ruling he found out later, like Muhammad said. Okay. Huh? Say that again? Oh, so there's a sacrifice in the story. Hey, what's the sacrifice? Hey, Fadal? That's why they were doing it. So what does that have to do with the issue of virtue? Are you? You're very close, are you? I'm looking for something.
Making more awareness, making more strength to get something
Sheikh, is it to do something with the slot? So you can carry the animal with you? Is that the three hajj? So they were carrying it, so that's why. In the tamattu, you can do it there. It could be just trying to link.
Another question I have, which brings me to the issue of slaughtering. If the Prophet was doing qiran, were all the companions doing tamattu, and the Prophet was the only one doing qiran, or was others doing it with him? And if so, were they opposing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by doing a hajj that he wasn't doing? Yeah, that's the answer, correct. When I explained the hadith, I didn't translate it. I went over it fast. لَوْ اسْتَقْبَلْتُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ مَسْتَدْبَرْتُ. I specifically chose not to explain that part because I wanted you guys just to hear the meaning of it, not the translation. It's something to do with the slaughter. First of all, we have to understand is the reason why the Prophet ﷺ said, I wish that this would be the case, was not because qiran is less than the tamattu. It was because he felt the companions were heartbroken. He told them to all change their, because some of them, because some of them were not carrying any hadi, any animals to slaughter. They were not carrying it. So he said to the ones who were not, they didn't have their hadi, sacrifice, the sacrifice animal, he said to all of those, turn it into tamattu' now. So if you don't have an animal to slaughter, tamattu' is better. If you have an animal to slaughter, qiran is better. And the reason why the Prophet ﷺ he regretted it, alayhi salatu wasalam, was he saw his companions were heartbroken. And so he said, I wish I can join in with you guys. If I had a chance, I would have done it with you. So you don't feel lonely in doing this act. Are we all together? So tamattu is good in one angle and qiran is good in the other angle. Now the author, rahimahullah, he's going to go into the chapter of the etiquette of ihram. Babu al-ihrami wa ma yata'allaqu bihi. The etiquette of ihram. What does ihram mean? Al-ihram, it means in the Arabic language ad-dukhulu fi at-tahrim, is to enter into the sanctuary, that which has been made haram from you. We all know that marriage and sexual intercourse with your spouse, your partner, is permissible. But this now becomes haram. You are entering that realm of prohibition. We all know wearing particular clothing is allowed. But it's not once you go into this state. So you're entering into a tahrim, prohibition. You can't wear perfume, which is normal and it's permissible for you. In this situation, no, it's not. That's what it means in the language, is to enter into something which is haram. Like in the Sharia, it means niyatu dukhuri fi hajjah, fi hajjin, aw umrah, aw huma ma'an. Niyatu dukhuri fi hajjah. It's to enter hajj, aw umrah, or to enter into umrah, or both of them. So some people think ihram is the clothing. That's what they believe. I'm wearing the clothing, or wearing the clothing. That's not what it is. What it really is that it's the intention that you make. You can wear the clothing and it means nothing. It means nothing. The haram is the clothing with the intention. Okay? The person, he proclaims, he utters the nusuk. What type of hajj he's going to do. If he's going to do umrah alone, if he's going to do hajj, if he's going to do both of them. He states the type of nusuk he's going to do. Okay? That's what he does. So it's called talafudu bin nusuk. As for at-talafudu bin niyya, speaking about what's in your heart and your intentions, by saying Allahumma inni nawaitu al-ihrama, oh Allah, I intended ihram bil-umrati for umrah, fayassirha li, make it easy for me, wa taqabbal minni innaka anta as-sami'ul alim, and accept it from me, for verily you are the one who hears and has all knowledge. That's all an innovation. There's no evidence for that. All you just say, labbayk umrah, khalas, nothing more, nothing less. Okay. The fuqaha mention that. Naam. This hadith, Bukhari narrated it. This hadith, it says that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to start the talbiyah. Because ma ahalla Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the word ahalla means what? It's to proclaim, it's to say. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would do his talbiyah from the mosque. That's what the hadith says. Illa min indil masjid. So some may come and say, I thought the people of Medina, their miqat was Dhul Hulayfa. I thought the people of Medina, they had to do it from Dhul Hulayfa. How is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing his ihram? And how is he doing his umrah from the masjid? You all know the famous story where a man came to Imam Malik, Imam Udari Hijra. And the man said to Imam Malik, I want to do ihram from the Prophet's masjid. And then Imam Malik said to him, لا تفعل, don't do that, أخشى عليك الفتنة, I fear fitna for you. And the man then he said, وأي فتنة هذا, what fitna are you scared for me for? أميال أزيدها, a couple of steps and a little distance, a little kilometers, I'm just increasing. I'm actually making it harder on myself by doing it from the masjid. And Imam Malik said to him, the fitna that I fear for you is that you believe that you're going to get closer to Allah, something that the Prophet ﷺ didn't do. That you believe there is a path to get closer to Allah that Nabi Muhammad didn't take. And then Imam Malik read the ayah, فَلِحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. So pay attention to this. Imam Malik was against this man doing what? His ihram and from the masjid. But Here the hadith says, ما أهل رسول الله. The messenger did not do his talbiyah and his ihlal illa min عند المسجد, from the masjid. The scholars, they prove that this masjid that's been referred to here is what? It's actually in Dil Hulayfa. It's a masjid in Dil Hulayfa. Here's the question I want you to all understand. Dil Hulayfa didn't have a masjid. So how do we say that the masjid of Dil Hulayfa, there was no masjid at the time of the Prophet in Dil Hulayfa? Am I making sense? There was no masjid. What did I mention to you guys before? I want you guys to ponder. What did I mention before? That two angels came to? An angel came down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An angel came down. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, salli fi hadhihi al-wadi al-mubarakah. Pray in this blessed valley. And what did he say to him after that? Pray. So intend Hajj and Umrah together. Sah? So what did the Prophet do? Before he done the Hajj and Umrah, what did he do? He prayed. So the masjid that he's referring to is where the Prophet prayed. Are we all together? And the context shows that it's Dhul Hulayfa. Because who's the one who narrated this hadith? Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar, a group of people, they said to him, As-Salim, the son, Muslim narrated min tariq Musa ibn Uqbah, and Salim ibn Abdullah, and sami'a abahu, Salim ibn Abdullah heard his father, يقول السيد saying, بيداؤكم هذه الذي تكذبون على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فيها. بيداء was an open land where the people saying that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did his ihram from here. He said, you're lying about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. ما أهل رسول الله, the messenger did not do the hilal, the ihlal, إلا من عند المسجد, next to this masjid, which is Dhul Hulayfa. He means Dhul Hulayfa. So Abdullah ibn Umar was talking about Dhul Hulayfa, the miqat of the people of Medina. The miqat of the people of Medina. Naam. Khalad ibn Sa'ib narrated from his father that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Atani Jibreel, Jibreel came to me. Fa'amarani, Jibreel commanded me, and amura ashabi, that I command my companions, and yarfa'u aswatam, that they raise their voices. Bil ihlali, that they raise their voices in the talbiyah, that they raise their voice. رواه الخمسة. The five narrated it. What is the خمسة? Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, and Ahmad ibn Hanbal. The four Sunan and Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Those five narrated it. وَصَحَاحُ التِرْمِذِيُّ وَتِرْمِذِي authenticated this. وَابْنُ حِبَّانَ and Ibn Hibban authenticated this. There are 11 scholars that authenticated this. Tirmidhi is one. The second one is Ibn Khuzaymah, the teacher of Ibn Hibban. And also Ibn Hibban himself, the student. That's three. Four, Al-Hakim. And Imam Hakim al-Naysaburi authenticated it. Al-Dhahabi authenticated it, and Imam al-Dhahabi. And Al-Bayhaqi also authenticated it. Abdul Haq al-Ishbili authenticated it. And Imam al-Nawawi authenticated it. الإمام الألباني رحمه الله authenticated it. الأعظمي authenticated it. الشيخ شعيب الأرناؤوط authenticated it. So it's authentic, this hadith. This hadith shows دليل, it's an evidence على مشروعية رفع الصوت, that the person raises their voice. They say it loudly. And the overwhelming majority of the scholars are of the opinion that this command, because the Prophet said, "An amura ashabi," that I command my companions, does it show obligation? Does it mean we have to? The scholars are of two opinions. The overwhelming majority of scholars, the Jumhur, they believe it's recommended. It's recommended. So remember, the Prophet commanded. How can they turn away from the command? How can they turn away from the command? They need a qarina. They need a textual evidence, something else, to move away from what? From the command of the messenger. Because the Prophet said, I was commanded to command my companions. So for them to say this command doesn't show obligation, they would need to bring a sarif. A sarif means another text, another delil, something else that shows that it's recommended. And so what they came with was al-mashaqqa, hardship. They said hardship will come from it if everyone has to keep saying it. The person has to raise his voice. They said this is hardship. And that's not a, it's not a strong delil. Strong delil. The qawl of the Zahiriyyah seems strong, which is the person has to raise their voice, and to do it walaw marra, even if you do once, at least you follow the command. Are we all together? You don't have to repeat it all the time. It's recommended for you to repeat it all the time, but for you to say it once is obligatory, wajib, because there's no delil to divert it. Are we all together? Question. Another discussion that came from the scholars is, what about the women and the men? Does the women also raise their voice? Or is this specific to the men? The raising of the voice here. Because the hadith says, أَن يَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَهُمْ. They raise their voices. بِالْإِهْلَالِ. The scholars here, they discussed this issue and they said, okay, how should we do it? The first view of scholars, they said, this is specific to the men. خَاصٌ بِالرِّجَالِ. It's unique for the men. And another group of scholars, they said, no. This is عام. This is general. It's for everyone. Men and women. Are we all together? And that which seems strongest, والعلم عند الله, knowledge with Allah Azza wa Jalla, is that this hadith is general and it can't be taken, or it can't be specified to only men. It needs the evidence, it needs a dalil. And as Shaykh Muhammad Ali Adim in Ethiopia said in the Sharah, Dhakhirat al-Uqba, which is the Sharah Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Sunan al-Nisa'i, he said they didn't bring any evidence for it. Shaykh Muhammad Ali says that there is no evidence that they provided to say that this is what? To say this is unique for the men. There's no evidence on their side. He said it when he was explaining Sunan Nasa'i. If I'm not wrong, a long time ago I read his Sunan Nasa'i, the 24th volume, he says that. He says it on the what? The book is 44 volumes. The 24th volume, he says it in there. Shaykh Muhammad. Before him, Ibn Hazm said, وَيَرْفَعُ الرَّجُلُ وَالْمَرْأَةُ. The man would raise his voice. The woman would raise her voice. بِهَا وَلَا بُدَّ. And it's necessary. وَهُوَ فَرْضَ. And it's obligatory, وَلَوْ مَرَّةُ, even if it's once. Another dalil that shows that that's the hadith, with unrestricted men and women, is our mother Aisha. She raised her voice so loud that the men can hear her. Are we all together? Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she raised it until she was heard. Aisha. The hadith is Ibn Abi Shayba narrated it عن عبد الرحمن بن القاسم عن أبيه قال خرج معاوية ليلة النفر. معاوية came out فسمع صوت تلبية. He heard a sound of تلبية. فقال, he said, من هذا, who is this? فقالوا, they said, عائشة اعتمرت من التنعيم. She came with her brother عبد الرحمن from تنعيم. It's her who you're hearing making that sound, very loud noise. فذكر ذلك لعائشة. عائشة was informed that معاوية asked and it was told to him. And then Aisha said, if Muawiyah was to ask me, who is this person whose sound I can hear? She said, I would have said to him, it's me, Aisha. I would have informed him, it's me. Meaning she was saying, it's permissible. And that's the qawl which is the strongest. Are we all together? It's the what? It's the strongest. وَلِذَلِكَ تَفَتْوَى الشَّيْخ بن بَازِ and شَيْخ بن عُثَيْمِينَ others who say that there's a fitna here, an issue of fitna. We know for Hajj there are things that are what? That are done. Hajj is the only time when men and women are in one place. Are we all together? Are we all together, brothers? And to take away that the Prophet's statement, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said to the companions, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ Take your what? Take your Hajj from me. Take your Hajj from me. We can't say that it was only the men that he was addressing and not the women. He was talking to men and women. This hadith, he's talking to the men and the women. To specify the men and say the women are not in there, Shaykh Abdullah ibn Salah al-Fawzan, he tries to say that, and he responds by saying, in the salah, if the imam does a mistake, what does the woman do? The women are at tasfiq, they clap. And the men, what do? They talk. At tasbih, the man says, subhanallah. But the women were not told to talk. What were they told to do? Clap to the imam, so that he knows he did a mistake. Are we all together? We will say, a ibadah cannot be done qiyas for another ibadah. Nabi Muhammad made the salah something what? That the women are not allowed to speak loud. Are we all together? It's a unique thing for the salah. And the hajj, both of them. He's the messenger who said it here, and he's the messenger who left it unrestricted here. Are we all together? Support now. Yeah, there's many issues that the Prophet ﷺ commanded where it was an obligation, but they only took it away from obligation with another evidence. Are we all together? Like the Prophet ﷺ commanded something, that command was left because of another command, another external evidence. Are we all together? Give you an example. Tahiyatul Masjid, for instance. تحية المسجد the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in a hadith إذا دخل أحدكم المسجد if one of you enters the masjid فلا يجلس حتى يصلي ركعتان he's not allowed to sit down until he prays what? 2 rak'ah this hadith shows us that if you enter the masjid you're not allowed to sit down unless you pray 2 rak'ah correct? So for me to turn away from this prohibition I mean I'm commanded to pray here am I not? And I'm told stay away from sitting down I can't Nabi Muhammad commanded me here. I cannot turn away based on any other dalil except something else he said. There's another dalil that turns it away from obligation. That is not obligatory, which is what? The messenger said, خمس صلوات. 5 prayers. كتبهن الله على العباد. Allah made it obligatory on the slaves. How many prayers? Huh? 5. Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib. Isha and Fajr. These 5 are what the Prophet ﷺ has made compulsory on the people. This now tells us where was Tahiyatul Masjid in the 5. Tahiyatul Masjid is not in the 5. So what we say is that we go back to the hadith where the Prophet commanded and we say that command was what? It was to encourage. It was targhib, istihbab, it's recommended. Are you with me? Like for example, when somebody says to someone, yeah, go play with your friends. Go play with your friends is a command. See, when a parent allows his child, dad, can I play with my friends? Go play with your friends. Go play with your friends is an amr. Like in hal taqtadi al-wujub, does it show obligation? The context can explain that to us. Are we all together? That's a mas'ala in usul al-fiqh. Lakin, if the messenger commands something, al-amr al-mutlaq, if the messenger unrestrictedly commands something, an alim or a scholar cannot say, no, it's not obligatory, it's highly recommended. He has to bring evidence. Why? Are we all together? It's important. He can, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, show that his command here is what? For example, Allah Ta'ala commands in the Quran, وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِيمَائِكُمْ أَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ Marry the women. Does everyone have to get married? Question. Is marriage obligatory? And the ayah says, أَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ. Command. No, it's not. You have other evidences that show it's not. Are we all together, brothers? We have the evidence of the woman who said to the Prophet ﷺ, my father is forcing me to get married to someone I don't want. And the Prophet ﷺ said to her, you don't have to get married if you don't want to. And she said to the Prophet ﷺ, I will never get married. How was the difference between that woman who said, I'm never going to get married, and the three men that came and visited the Prophet's house, and one of them said, I'm never going to get married? The Prophet consented to one. He allowed that woman who said, I'm never going to get married. But when the man said, I'm never going to get married, he didn't let him. And he told him off. What's the difference? Huh?
Because the man thought he was going to get closer to Allah by not marrying his woman.
Ah, sahih, jameel, Muhammad. Jazakallah khairan. The woman, she wasn't trying to get closer to Allah by not getting married. She just didn't want to. So the person has a choice to do that. Lakin, the man who was trying to get closer to Allah by never getting married, he made it an ibadah, an act of worship to not get married. And that's not allowed. If you don't want to get married for your own personal reason, that's fine. But if you say, I'm not going to get married because Allah loves this and I'm going to do it for Allah's sake, it becomes a what? It becomes a bid'ah, it becomes an innovation. The point I'm coming to is, the Qur'an and the Sunnah can command something and it can sometimes be recommendation. It doesn't have to always be obligatory. And the only thing that will determine it being recommended or not is another dalil, another text. Okay? Another text. Naam. Yeah.
Not with the Hajj, but coming back to the marriage again. So does it mean that if somebody like who doesn't want to be not getting married just to be close to Allah, he says that he doesn't want to get married, maybe he's not getting a good spouse, or right? So he can continue with that throughout his life? There shouldn't be, he should not be forced by his parents or by his relatives.
So if a person has the ability to get married, has the wealth, has the physical ability, chooses not to get married for his own personal reasons, maybe he wants to pursue a career, maybe he's got a good job, he doesn't want to do it, maybe he just doesn't like the headache that comes with it, etc. It's permissible for him. He's leaving off something good. Sunnah of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is leaving a recommended thing, but he's not a sinner. He's not sinning for doing that. He's leaving off a good thing. He's losing the chance of having children. And then Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what did he say? فَإِنِّي مُكَاثِرٌ بِكُمُ الْأُمَمُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The day of judgment, I'm going to say to all the nations, look at my ummah, look how large and great they are in number. You're going to make the Prophet lose that opportunity. You will, but it is not wajib. It is wajib lakin. If the brother is, his desires is very high, he's committing zina, he's looking around too much. Are we all together? And he has the ability, and he says, I don't want to get married. Now he has to get married. Wajib for you to get married. Because now you're going and you're doing haram. Or haram thoughts are coming to your mind. But a brother who doesn't, he's carrying on his life, he doesn't want to, that doesn't even come to his mind, he can. Like Ibn Taymiyyah never got married in his life. And Imam Nawawi never got married in his life. Never.
The other examples, because of course those are the imams, and for their spirituality, you cannot compare with the men. But I'm coming to the point, like if your parents are asking you to get married, and you are just trying to run away, then you are not being sinful?
Not necessarily, no. No. Not necessarily.
You're not following, of course sunnah is one thing, it is not obligatory, but at the same time, if parents want to...
Yeah, it's good to be obedient towards your parents. But sometimes, some situations, generally speaking, it could be because of marriage can sometimes cause greater harm that needs to be taken into consideration. Someone may not get married because he just does not feel he can fulfill that right, or he can do what is needed from him. He can commit to taking someone else's life on board. But he has the ability to get married. When the old generation, when they were ready to marry you off, they would sit you down, especially if it was a woman, mainly from my country. When they want to marry the girl off, they come to her, the father and the mother would sit down and say, dua or a curse. And they will choose the person. They'll say, this brother, you're going to marry, dua or a curse. Is that common in the culture? Not common in the Indian culture. So she's in front of her parents and they're like, you have to get married. And also you have to marry this brother. And so, subhanAllah, sometimes they do get married and they spend the rest of their life in stress, hardship. You see, an ongoing problem, children come from it. You see, not that I'm saying parents are always thinking bad. No, not at all. SubhanAllah, it's very important to consult your parents when you're going to get married. Because they have the basira, the insight to understand where it's all at. They're looking everything from a very deeper observation, without a shadow of a doubt. But it has to come from both sides. It has to come from both sides. You all know, is there anyone better than Abu Bakr in this ummah? Is there anyone better? But when he asked for Fatima, did the Prophet give it to him? When Abu Bakr asked for Fatima, for her hand in marriage, did the Prophet accept it? So not everybody who's good is necessarily good for you. Does that make sense? Person might be good, righteous, noble, but they're not necessarily good for you. Are we all together? The Prophet ﷺ, when Umar asked, he didn't. When Ali asked, he did. Ali's virtue and the compatibility. He found that they were compatible. Are we all together, brothers? So this is very important. That's another issue, not Hajj. That's called marriage. Yeah? Hajj, yeah. We'll stop there. We'll take questions, inshallah, if you guys have any questions.